please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Good afternoon. You're with us here on a fresh new edition of Midcap Radar. It's a Friday, but there is no reprieve. There is no relief. The market's down a full 100 points. At 10,253, we are pushing it lower at the day's low as we start this edition of Midcap Radar. I mean, there's only one sectoral index which is in the green, and that's the PSU Bank Index. At 11 o'clock in the morning today, that index was up almost 1.5%. It's barely up 0.33%. But that's the only thing which is higher. Everything else across the board is lower. Metals, energy, commodities. I mean, you look at pharmaceuticals, FMCG, anything between 1% to about 2.5% cuts through these sectoral indices. You've got pockets of activity, like, for example, I think Jayaprakash Associates at the bottom of your screen is buzzing, but that's essentially event-related, news-related. Otherwise, there is broad pressure which is weighing down. So, Samir Afno.
Hi, Prashant. Good afternoon to you as well. And I think even in Europe, the expectation is that it would be a mixed open, so not a lot of fireworks over there. Of course, it's fears around the trade policy, that U.S.'s trade policy, that continue to spook investors, and that, I suppose, is the theme.
So that's later in the evening today. Ashwani Gujral is with us right now. Ashwani, thanks very much. Afternoon. I mean, so 11:30, you were saying maybe it's time to sell. I mean, if you sold, you're in a fair bit of money. Your reading of things now.
See, I would think this is the time to cover those shorts if people are short. One thing I had mentioned, that you know, banking is not falling. The Nifty is down 100. Bank Nifty is down only 68. That shows, you know, huge amount of strength in banking. So if you know, the market has to come back going into the close, I think banks will recover fairly sharply. One bank in particular, ICICI Bank, seems to be showing strength from lower levels. So for the moment, I think people should cover shorts and maybe get long on the Bank Nifty. And you know, the downtrend for the day is now fairly mature, so unlikely that you will see a further fall on the Nifty. So you get long on the stronger index, which is the Bank Nifty, and try to trade it on the upside. It's been a relentless fall, so chances are that some amount of pullback is due going into the close, because global markets are not showing great follow through on the downside. Having said that, individual stocks, Balkrishna Industries, a buy with a stop of 1080, target of 1140. PNB is a buy with a stop of 99, target of 106. BOI is a buy with a stop of 104, target of 112. None of these PSU banks have given up any gains. So maybe there is some expectation or something is happening here, because if the market is down 100, you can't expect them to be going higher. And that's what's happening for the last, you know, 3 or 4 hours.
You'd be okay taking these longs and PSU Bank longs home?
This is, you know, last year you could take anybody home. But this year, you know, you have to play it safe. Have your fun and go.
So that is a no. Bye-bye by 3:30, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else that you could do? I mean, that you could, apart from the PSU Bank space?
Something also is going on in this, you know, PSU space overall, which means MMTC, STC, these guys, they, you know, tend to move off and on, but yesterday they moved, today again they are moving. So maybe some expectations, etc., are getting built into this space in terms of, you know, whatever stake sale, etc. So something interesting is also happening here. Plus, you know, the tire space, as I said, Balkrishna Industries, etc., they are tending to pick up from here. Overall, today is a day where, you know, corporate lenders are doing better than, you know, the retail lenders. And yesterday it was the opposite. So overall, what you can see is that one day the markets move in one way, and the next day in another way. Another thing you can possibly look at is, you know, Shriram Transport. That looks extremely good because that's into CV financing. So these are stocks, you know, individual plays that people can look at.
All right, Ashwani, thanks very much for your trading ideas this afternoon. Let's just focus then to the mining ban in Goa. that has come into effect from today. And earlier this morning, we caught up with Anil Agarwal, the chairman of Vedanta, who calls it very unfortunate. And he, in fact, says that there's a lot of clarity which is required now in terms of how the auctions will be conducted going forward.
The curtain has come down. The entire industry has completely come to the halt. This point of time, when it has been cancelled, we cannot even pay for one day wages, salary for anybody. So this is very, very unfortunate.
Company on our radar now is Intrasoft Tech. Well, Ventura Capital is betting big on the company. They have initiated coverage on this stock. They have a buy rating and they expect a target of 1,555 over the next 18 months. So that's essentially a doubling of the stock price from here. Arvind Kajaria, MD of the company, now joins in. Mr. Kajaria, good afternoon. Good to speak with you. But, what I was interested was more in finding out if the underlying fundamentals actually support this kind of a projection by one of the brokerages. They go on to say that they expect your orders to grow at a CAGR of 33%, up to that FY20 period to about 67 odd lakh units. You think this is doable by you? What is your order book currently? And you think this is achievable?
Good afternoon. Yes, the size of the addressable market is certainly huge and even larger than the numbers you said. The issue is competition. The issue is to, technologically create an environment where we're able to garner all the orders. So all that will remain a challenge. But I historically said that, we've been going anywhere between 25 to 30%. And, our investment in technologies over the years, I think, will pay off. And, we believe that similar growth rate should be possible. So I haven't calculated what the brokerage has done, really. Mm. But if, those numbers match, then we are looking to keep up with the numbers that we've achieved historically.
Mr. Kajaria, they're basically talking about the order growth to pick up pace from the 25 to 30% that you've done to about 33% CAGR over the next couple of years. Very roughly top down, would you be, because you also alluded to competition, etc., which are going to be real challenges, would growth be faster than what you've done historically, or could it actually be, yeah?
Well, if you see the last three quarters, we've done, 9%, and then 6%, and then close to 26, 27%. So the orders are rising faster. I'm saying that, there will be challenges along the way because, as we see, in any business, the size of the addressable market is so large that it's bound to attract a lot of competition. So it's not that we're afraid of them, but yet certainly we'll have to put in a lot of hard work and effort to ensure that. Mm.
So now Q3 is seasonally your best, your strongest quarter, right? So what is the outlook now for Q4 in terms of what you might be able to do in terms of your revenue? And also, FY19, what are you hoping to do on the top line?
Yes, Q3 is the holiday quarter, so it's traditionally our best. January to March, it normally takes a dip because, the contracts, etc., are being renegotiated. But I've got on record to say that, we are going to probably be at same as last year's growth, which is around 30%. For the coming year, we remain confident. We feel that these levels of growth are sustainable. And, we will continue to invest in technologies, generate free cash flow, and try to move the top line of the business. That is where our maximum efforts are being placed.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. Let's just talk about the other one, which is operating profit growth of 36%. This is again the broker point saying that they expect you to do 36% growth. EBITDA. Could you talk to us about that, whether that is possible? Could put that number in some context for us?
I can't comment on their numbers, but I can tell you what we're trying to achieve. Retail basically is a top-line game where the more top-line you achieve, the better negotiating power you have with the vendors. So if you grow the top line, we would continue to invest our monies into tech and growing the business to hiring more and more people, which are expensive. So there you could see a pressure on margins and EBITDA as we move forward. But nonetheless, I think there should be growth in absolute EBITDA, maybe not to the extent that the top line grows, but we believe that there would be slight EBITDA accretion.
You know, in the last
quarter... I cannot comment on the brokerages report.
Yeah, yeah. No, last quarter, I think EBITDA was down, right? And that was a specific issue. I mean, there was a company which went bust and they shifted a lot of their products offline. Online. And there was heavy...
Please go ahead.
No, there was a heavy discounting on those products, etc. The reason I put that point to you is because I think over the last 24 hours, another very large retailer, I think toy retailer in the US, has filed for bankruptcy. So are we likely to see a similar kind of situation in Q4 as well, Q4 and beyond?
See, I again can't comment on that. But what I can comment is that if you want to see a top-line growth, which is certainly a record, there's a certain amount of investment has to be made into tech and other growth products, into developing the platform. And that money does come out of EBITDA, and therefore, you know, the margins would continue to be under pressure.
Okay, what about cash flows then? And since you're talking about this bit of investment that is required, could you give us a sense of what, you might be toying with?
Yes, so, we believe that we built a strong enough brand name, and most of the vendors are now quite dependent on us, and our entire growth we expect to be funded by vendors' credit. So as the number of days, the working capital cycle is about 14 days now, as that reduces, you should see a growth in our free cash flow. And that's the money that we're going to use to invest back into tech and grow the top line, as I've been saying for the last few minutes.
Uh-huh. Mr. Gujral,
so the model really is to use the supplier's credit to fuel the growth and see a slight increase in absolute EBITDA so that, you know, your ROE and ROCE starts to go up.
Just one last question. You're extremely dependent on Amazon. Amazon, if for nothing, is known to squeeze, the entire ecosystem extremely hard to the benefit for the consumer. Do you see any risks there?
Yes, the ecosystem is very hard, but we spent 8 long years in building systems that mitigate the risk. And, all those tech that I keep talking about is basically to circumvent and mitigate those risks and to ensure that whatever we promise on the platform, we deliver, which is why we have a 97% rating and which is what gives us the top line, because it's you get a premium placement. The higher your ratings, higher your placement, which is what increases the top line.
It's like we're heading towards that 10,250-odd mark, so down about 1%. The Sensex is down nearly 300 points. And look at some of the culprits. So there's TCS and Reliance. Both the big boys are sitting near the low point of the day. And a lot of these pharma stocks also, actually. So look at Lupin, Cipla, Dr. Reddy's. All of these are stocks which are definitely near the lows. And not just that, we've seen PSU banks having a good run, actually, through the entire session. But they started coming off at about noon. And all of these names continue to head a little bit lower. So while they're still holding out in the green for now, say something like a Union Bank, Andhra, Allahabad, etc., but all of them have corrected about 1% in this last hour alone and would pretty much be heading lower. But with that, we'll wrap up on Midcap Radar.